then when I went to Germany, I ended up, I met Stockhausen when I was there right away, and eventually started working with him. And this was a whole different way of looking at scores, because he, I had, by that time, I had done all kinds of multiphonics and really weird techniques of going, all this kind of stuff. And Stockhausen had these quarter notes and half notes, and everything had to be exactly a quarter note, or I guess it's crotchets, right, where you are? Anyway, they had to be 4/16 long without this kind of romantic envelope. So it was a very specific language, which I later found out, oh, that comes from Messiaen, which, of course, Merle Noir. How many people know Merle Noir, the blackbird? There's there's a section in there where we go da dee da da, and very, very straight, and it's become a performance practice, but and nobody would think of doing it in a romantic way, but there are, that goes back to Varese. You've heard of Varese density 21.5. This is another one where you're really working with blocks of sound, and Varese said, okay, follow this strictly in time. It's not a romantic Frenchified thing. It's kind of anti-Syrinx. It's got to be very, very exact. So that's one line of playing, right? And then there's, of course, another one that comes from Debussy that has more the traditional way of making phrases, changing your vibrato, changing colors, doing all this fun stuff. And then there's another kind that Amy mentioned. What about all this blip blip music, right? And I grew up, when I went to school, it was in the 70s, and we were still discovering like the music of the 60s, which were a lot of blip blip. Berio is the basic example that's survived all that. But what about all this music that sounds like it was just, it's like that, and it's supposed to sound like that if it's written then, because the idea was to shock people. It was not to make some kind of beautiful line, make music that makes sense. We had just come out of a whole lot of, you know, pyrotechnics of the 19th century, early 20th century, then we went back to neoclassical. We had beautiful sonatas. Oh, and I'm forgetting the impressionism, right? All that. So we had all this. And then there was the war, and that kind of destroyed everybody's idea of world order, and the whole avant-garde stuff came after that, starting with the late 40s, but especially 50s, especially in the 60s, that people wanted to rewrite also music. And that's why when you have these pieces that look like they're disjoint, well, they are, but there's a tension behind it. There, you don't just go, like, you hear people just whipping off Berio from memory, but that's not the point. The point was to da da da, yeah, ba ba. You know, that you didn't know what the audience didn't know what the next note was going to be. What's the next gesture? And suddenly, very extreme changes in dynamic, and a couple of multiphonics there or overblowing. So some of those pieces that look difficult and awful and ugly or whatever, they're supposed to be that way. Not all of them, but that's one of the things to one of our jobs when we find some score, to find out, like, where is it coming from, right? Is it supposed to be, and then, you know, there's all these waves. After people got tired of doing that, well, first I should say, in the whole 60s, even the 70s, there's a whole lot of repertoire that's made where people are exploring all these new sounds. Also John Cage saying, you know, noise is music, and listening to everything. So you have a lot of compositions that just try different things for the sake of being different, and also expanding the repertoire. Jazz people did it anyway all the time, singing and playing and doing bending of sounds, and then the classical, and rock people had that, but then the classical musicians too. So, but people eventually got sick of doing that, and then started integrating those sounds, which had become a vocabulary. They started making actual music with it. So in the 80s, for example, I'm just being very general, you started having sounds like Sariajo that uses air sounds or quarter tones, but not to shock you, but because it's a new kind of music. Instead of having major and minor scales with the dominant to tonic, that's where you get your tension, she would create a tension of having air moving into sound, right? And so that would be its own kind of scale, if you want. So you can't cover the whole history of new music, but it's interesting that you can cover a lot of it through flute repertoire. You can find the history of music represented in lots of different solo pieces. So I was working with Stockhausen, who was doing this very exact notation, and I also met Sariajo about a year later. Kaija Sariajo is a Finnish composer living in Paris. Sariajo was coming more from a Debussy tradition, which totally threw me at first, because I was so into Stockhausen, and I was trying to interpret her scores like Varese Density 21.5, and it doesn't work at all. So those are one of the first questions you have to ask. How is the composer using the notation? It's like the difference between French Baroque and Italian Baroque with the crotchets or with the eighth notes, and all that. Or what's the difference between Debussy and Varese? So that's kind of like a general language question. That's a very quick introduction. On my website, hidden in kind of a mess under repertoire, there's I've kind of done a historical listing of solo flute pieces, which you could check it out. It's very personal. It's what's in my repertoire, like the first person to do this, the first person to do that. It just gives kind of an overview.